Good morning, everyone. Hope you're doing well and keeping safe. I know this is the last session of the day. You must be tired. So let us jump in right out. I had a chance to present another session in the morning with regard to 5G and small cells. This session is with regard to the virtualization of the RAN, how virtualized and disaggregated 3GPP RAN and small cells are going to work. So we are going to discuss that particular topic. Before I get started, let me thank Linda Guzman from Comtech and her team for inviting us to present at this wonderful event. My name is Prasad Bhandaru. I'm the Wireless Program Manager at Cyient. I have around 16 years of experience in the industry. I have been working with various wireless carriers. I have been working with various CSPs and OEMs, deploying the network, designing, planning, business case analysis, and various other tasks. My team is responsible for 4G and 5G communication projects and customer relationships. In sync with the sales and delivery, we are responsible for the solution architecture and pre-sales. I do have an MBA from University of Maryland, and I have an MS in Electrical Engineering from University of Texas at Arlington. So, and my company, Cyient, it's a world-class systems integrator. We work with carriers across the globe. Our main focus is fiber, but we also deploy small cells. And we also do a lot of wireless engineering, architecture engineering. So we are pretty diversified engineering services company. So that's about us. Now let us get into the details of the presentation. So 5G promise. So before I jump into the 5G promise, we discussed this in the morning. We essentially said, hey, if you want to achieve the 5G promise of, let us say, 100 Mbps throughput, low latency of less than 10 milliseconds, seamless handoff between the licensed and unlicensed spectrum, if you want to achieve that sweet spot, you probably need a big amount of spectrum that is free and available, which is millimeter wave, and you also need number of small cells, ultra-dense network that can actually be used to deploy this millimeter wave network, because millimeter wave has a typical coverage of around 500, 600 feet, and small cells you can put at a height of 30, 40 feet height. So there is no height advantage. We discussed this in the morning. So that's why we were saying this is a match made in heaven, in the sense you want to have small cells, you want to have millimeter wave 5G, which can actually give you the three or four important topics that we are thinking that are the requirements for 5G. Key use cases, 5G can support your IoT, connected cars, remote surgery, mobile broadband, MVNO, but above all, I think it will be more towards the education that is going to come first. Like I have a six-year-old daughter, and she was telling me the other day, she wants to do, she wants to see planet formation, how the planets are formed in the virtual reality, in the augmented reality. So I believe education will be the kind of like a priority sector compared to any other sector, but there are a number of use cases that 5G is promising. But in order to support this 5G promise, in order to support various demands of service agility, quality of service, and latency requirement, we need an ultra-dense network. But to deploy that ultra-dense network, we need a fortune, because so many small cells are there. So the total cost of ownership need to make sense. So as we try to deploy millimeter wave as a capacity layer, today's largely macro cell network will evolve into dense and ultra-dense heterogeneous networks. These ultra-dense networks are expected to cover most of the urban areas, indoor as well as outdoor. We expect indoor and antennas within 10 meters of each other. We expect outdoor antennas wherever there is a hotspot, covering 400, 600 feet distance from the small cell. So it's going to be interesting as we deploy millimeter wave as your capacity layer. These deployments, as I said, will cause a fortune, and you need to figure out the total cost of ownership. The main reason for this problem is today's architecture, the 4G architecture of the cell site, it's more like a monolithic architecture. It does not have a functional split. It does not have a software separation. It does not have a hardware disaggregation. So it's very rigid architecture. Either you need to buy the whole setup from somebody like Samsung or Ericsson, or you need to just keep quiet. There is no middle ground here. These deployments include, at the same time, whenever you want to launch a new feature, whenever you want to launch a new product in the market, you need to go through changing of the cards, changing of the cabinets, increasing the capacity, changing the RRU. So it's a, the OPEX is pretty high. The CAPEX is also pretty high. So that's why I was saying we need to move towards software-defined mobile networks. That is going to reduce your CAPEX and OPEX. At the same time, you can spin your services much faster than what it used to be. So that is your 5G promise, and that's why I think you can achieve your 5G promise. So coming back to software-defined mobile networks. So what is a software-defined mobile network? What is a software-centric approach? So the programmability of the network, the software-based programmability of the network, it helps a rapid and comprehensive deployment of the new functions and features. It supports new services introduction and improved radio network performance. As you can see in the picture, we are at a network defined and constrained by the RAN. Our network is defined and constrained by the RAN. We are having closed loop interfaces. We are having a monolithic and proprietary system. All these will probably migrate into a flexible radio capacity allocation based on traffic demands. We will be more focused towards network services will be defined by the operational model. We'll have a more modular approach. We can deploy VNS on the card servers, maybe from Dell. So that flexibility is going to be there in the software-defined network. Especially if you go to enterprises or any other industry verticals, the APIs using the services should be supported using APIs that are designed to manage resources in an end-to-end network and won't function properly without network automation. Additionally, many of the software-defined functions will occur in the virtualized environment, either at or near the user, near the edge. So the central office needs to be upgraded, which enables support for newer breed of low-latency services. So that's why I'm saying, so you need to migrate from, you need to migrate to something too. So software-defined mobile networks can actually achieve that. So software-defined mobile networks will probably give us flexibility of the network deployment, time to market, how fast we can bring in a feature into the market. OPEX is saved because you don't have to do so many truck rolls to swap the cards, to do the ATP, to do the whether the site is working or not. So the CNI process itself is automated. So it's going to reduce your OPEX significantly. At the same time, it is also going to reduce your CAPEX significantly. In a sense, you can mix and match your hardware. You can put a Samsung radio and a VRV software and a probably a Samsung card. So you can do mix and match. So that will save your CAPEX significantly. If you go to the next slide, this is your typical breakdown. As I said, the monolithic architecture is there, and then you have this virtualized architecture. You will have a physical network function, which is your augmented, which is your AU, that is going to be on top of the tower. And then on the right side, you have a data center where you have multiple VNS installed, which is your control plane, user plane domain, control plane domain. All these are installed as VNS in a data center. So you are going to divide your RAN, the cell site at the top, the base station at the bottom. You're going to divide that into a RU slash RRH, a DU, and a CU. So that segregation is going to come into the picture. Virtualization also comes with number of functional scripts, shared infrastructure of different radio access technologies. Virtualization gives us the ability to deploy baseband units in the most suitable location. We don't need to have a baseband unit right at the cell site. We can deploy it wherever we want. It helps us when the baseband function is in the data center, virtualization allows resource pools, which reduces provisioning requirements, which it's easy to spin up and spin down your new eNodeB instance. So that's a big advantage of virtualization. Ability to set up and tear down services on demand by user requirement and consumption profile. We can do that. So the decomposition is going to be a RU, CU, and DU decomposition. I think at some point we will do the functional layer split. Let me go there. So by the way, this is your typical access unit and the customer premises equipment. So you have a radio unit there, you have a DU there. It's a 44R radio. You are getting around 100 Gbps throughput. So that is a typical fixed wireless setup that you have. So this is a functional split. As you can see, you have a PTCP, RLC, MAC, physical, and RF. Most of the carriers are deploying a split 2 architecture, in the sense the time sensitive applications are deployed closer to the RRH, the time insensitive applications are deployed far in the data center. At the same time, that is from a hardware standpoint. From a software standpoint of view, when you segregate the control plane, the user plane using the CUPS architecture, the user plane is more towards the RRH, and the control plane is deployed further away. So the UP and CP split is going to help you to decentralize. More functional splits than 4G LTE with a centralized unit to integrate the control function as a control plane and tolerate the level it is. So that helps you to solve the latency issue. And there is a radio resource management enabling optimal resource management from several users. Like if the user is at the edge, if the user is close to the site, how do you actually, whom do you serve better, whom do you serve the bare minimum that you need to. So that kind of radio resource management is also not good. Last but not least, you are going to have a shared architecture, shared infrastructure. That's going to reduce your cost. So how to virtualize is going to be one of the big questions. How to virtualize RAN systems to implement the latency and jitter requirements. Location of the RAN functions, which is determined by the service function requirements and the requirements. So we believe the second, the option split 2 is going to be more RLC, MAC, physical is going to be deployed once. PDCP and RLC are going to be deployed in the data center, while MAC and physical and RF are going to be deployed in the near the RRH in the DU. Disaggregation of the baseband hardware from the software helps the operators to combine the best-in-class functions. Disaggregation is a natural process, and it's relatively simple for the centralized unit, because those functions can be easily virtualized. Disaggregation of the distributed unit is more challenging because of real-time processing that needs to happen for the MAC layer and the physical layer, this one. So good chance that PDCP and RLC are deployed in the data center, but MAC and physical are deployed in the closer to the RF, and you have a front hall that connects both of them. In the case of the companies like Cisco, Altiostar, they did deploy fully virtualized digital unit, mainly because they had a very fat pipe. The front hall was pretty big. So that's how we can split the network between RLC, PDCP, and the MAC physical and RF layers. So this is a typical fixed wireless deployment we did. As you can see, we have a fixed wireless radio on the tower, and then we brought in a edge cloud, which is your DU. We have a VRAN instance there, a control plane and a user plane. And then you have a core instance in the core cloud. So this is your typical 5G fixed wireless deployment. Before I go to CNI, the radio signal processing stack in both LTE and 5GNR is a service chain of functions, which is processed sequentially. The functions are controlled using the signal derived from the packet core, specifically the MME. The service diversity adoption protocol and the packet data convergence protocol, the radio element control function, CU, these stack functions are packet level manipulations, header compressions over the air suffering that are not time sensitive and can be easily implemented in a virtualized environment. But the mid-haul links connects between the CU and DU is defined differently. The CU location is excellent for deploying user plane function. And the decomposed packet core architecture, known as the CUPS architecture. As the RAN and core are getting decomposed, it's logical to create an intermediate location. These locations would consolidate CU workloads and a user plane function from the mobile core. The distributed user plane functions facilitate the offload, enabling local virtual services. So splitting the architecture like this will create two additional transport domains, namely front hall and mid hall. So what you see in this picture, it's a front hall. These domains are implemented when remote radiohead, RRH DU split or CU DU split is exposed. In some cases, it is possible to implement a front haul over dark fiber. Probably that's what we are doing between the in the option two split, RLC PDCP and MAC physical RF split, which is basically a transport of time domain and frequency domain baseband samples between the DU and the RRH or RRU. In other cases, transport techniques rely on the Ethernet or IP. The WDM must be employed. Mid-haul is basically the transport of the GTP packets and associated control plane between the CU and DU. This type of transport again is implemented in the IP kind of environment. So once you split your VNode B, it will bring cost-efficient front haul network. It will lose the transport network licensing requirement. It's long distance support with performance degradation as RTT increases. And it also has efficient and flexible resource planning of the VNode. So this is a typical example of a fixed wireless deployment in the 5G. As you can see, there is a AU near the cell site, which is your close to your CPE. And then there is edge cloud, and then there is core cloud. The certain functions like as we discussed above, MAC, physical, and RF, these functions are deployed at the very close to the RRH, and RLC and PDCP, these are deployed in the data center. As you can see in this picture, the access unit is a physical network function, which is your RRH, located between the 5G CPE, which is at your home, and the eNode B, or the vNode B, which provides MAC and physical and RF functions. It processes the packets by connecting to the CPE wirelessly according to the 5G interface standard. It is deployed at a remote site, and AU sends and receives the signal. So that's what your AU does. AU provides aesthetics and compact design for easy and efficient installation. AU supports Ethernet backhaul. AU supports Ethernet backhaul, and it also does the daisy chaining of the connection. So AU is going to be closer to the house. It connects to your CPE, and it also connects to your edge data center. The market data center, the link between the AU and the market data center is Ethernet. The latency between the AU and the market data center is not so critical, mainly because the real-time functions are not placed in the market data center. However, increasing delay may impact the throughput of the applications or somewhat the appearance of the applications. Usually, AU utilizes multiple antenna technologies, MIMO, beamforming, all these technologies are deployed at the RRH. And then comes your VNode B, virtual node B, that is deployed at your market data center as a VNF. That provides RRC and core interfaces. VNode B also provides RLC, PDCP, and GTP functions. Tunneling protocols, all these are managed with a VNode B. That one we saw before. Functional decomposition of a well-defined interfaces and splits allows even more flexibility beyond the hardware and software disaggregation. So we are going to disaggregate the control plane component and the user plane component. So we have a horizontal disaggregation. We have a horizontal decomposition, and we have a vertical separation between the control plane and the user plane. So this is a typical commissioning and integration process between of a GNode B. As you can see, we have a tenant setup, VIM registration, software loading. These are all the prerequisites. And then we have a decommissioning, DU commissioning, DU grow, cell grow, post checks. If you take some of the major carrier deployments these days, most of this work is automated. The commissioning and integration process is automated. So in this particular picture, you see a 4G card on the left, and you see a 5G CDU50 on the right. So this kind of deployments are happening these days. So the reason why I was bringing the transport medium, whether it is CPRI, eCPRI, whether it is some sort of Ethernet, dark fiber, mainly because that actually is dictated by the latency you can support because of the transmission time interval. So usually in this type of deployment, it can support a fiber length of around 15 to 20 kilometers max, approximately less than 20 kilometers. So your open CPRI or the CPRI protocol will still support your legacy RRU. Your XRAN gateway will be still there. In the microwave deployments, in the millimeter wave deployments, you'll be using something like a F1 interface. In the RU deployments, in the sub 6 gigahertz deployments of the old, you'll be still using your open CPRI. The problem with the open CPRI is it's always on. So in order to support the time sensitive functions that you are going to place at DU, you need to have a higher capacity, maybe a giga or more. So that's why I was saying before, the front haul is going to be critical as you try to move your more time-sensitive functions towards the DU. The CU implementation is pretty simple, right? Because there are no time-sensitive functions there. The RLC, MAC, and physical, these are going to be time functions, and they are placed at the DU. If you virtualize them and if you are too far from the RRH, that will cause latency. So the MAC supported distance is around is less than 20 kilometers. So I tried to explain that we are migrating from a monolithic fixed architecture to a more distributed divisive architecture with a control plane and user plane separation, with a hardware segregation between your RRH, DU, and CU. So let us look at a summary of findings and key takeaways. These findings also kind of like, we are thinking that gigabit LTE performance is more localized. So the coverage is going to be short, the small cells are going to be there, so your LTE performance, the gigabit performance will be localized. As I said, small cell CBRS deployments, I believe they are going to be critical. Significant outdoor 5G coverage is feasible by co-locating with the existing LTE site. Out to in the sense of transferring between the millimeter wave and the 5G, millimeter wave and the subbands, that kind of coverage is not feasible with millimeter wave. So you cannot have in-building propagation with millimeter wave. You do need to coexist with the satellite and band functions in the kind of this system. Non-standalone modal enables faster time to market. So these are some of the findings and key takeaways. How do we split your architecture, whether you do a layer 2 split, layer 8 split? It also depends upon what kind of applications, what kind of functions you are going to support at the end of the day. If you are going to support more time-sensitive functions, you need to have more processing-hungry functions like RLC, MAC, physical, closer to the network, closer to your RRH. And you can still have your non-time-sensitive functions, control plane functions, in the CU that is located far from the RRH. So it's all about what is the distance that you can maintain on the front haul, what is the distance you need to maintain on the mid haul. If you can have a reasonable front haul, you can have multiple hundreds of RRH, you can have tens or hundreds of DUs in a given market. So these are some of the high-level takeaways that I wanted to bring to your attention. But again, the disaggregation of the RAN, the breakup of the architecture or the hardware from a DU, RU, CU standpoint, or operation of software from a control plane, user plane standpoint of view, I think these are going to be critical as we move towards millimeter wave deployment or ultra densification of the RAN network or more control, more centralized control using a radio interface control or a multi-RAN software-defined approach. These things are going to be crucial as we move towards the densification of the network. So thanks a lot. Thanks for your time. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the session, I try to keep this more at a business level or at a very high level. I don't want it to bore you at the end of the day. But if you have any more questions, if you want to discuss any topics, feel free to reach out to me on my LinkedIn page or send me a quick note and we can have a chat. Again, thanks for your time. Have a good day, and hopefully we'll meet sometime soon. Thank you.